Hello and welcome to Art House, a Flatland conversation about all things art cinema. My name is John McGrath. I'm a producer for Flatland at Kansas City PBS. And guess what? I'm also a filmmaker. Okay, joining you today is Kevin Willmott. Kevin, thanks for being on the show.
Thanks. Good to be here, my friend.
Yeah, I can't believe I got Kevin Willmott. This is awesome, man. All right, Kevin's a writer-director of over 10 feature films. He's also written with Spike Lee, most notably for Black Klansman, where he won an Oscar and a BAFTA. Again, let's not forget the BAFTA.
Much love to the BAFTA.
Much best to the BAFTA. Kevin's also a professor at the University of Kansas, where he teaches, among other things, screenwriting. Kevin, again, thanks for being here.
Yeah, thank you, my brother.
Okay, my next guest is Morgan Cooper. Morgan, thanks for being here.
Yeah, thanks for having me.
Okay, Morgan is a Kansas City native, born and bred here in Kansas City. He's had a prolific career as a cinematographer and a director. He's directed over 5 films, most notably Bel Air, which takes a dramatic look at the Fresh Prince of Bel Air, and he did You Shoot Videos for Adorama that got a staff pick on Vimeo. And I think, what do we say inside in the green room? Like 3 of your 5 are staff picks on Vimeo?
Yeah.
I'm telling you, for us film geeks, that's like total. I was like, dang, I want one of those.
So, yeah, it's super cool.
Yeah, and Morgan just got signed to CAA, the Creative Arts Agency in Los Angeles, California. And he also got signed to the production company Chromista, founded by the Oscar-nominated director Darren Aronofsky. So again, thanks for being here, you guys. Okay, so the topic of the show, it seems kind of broad and elementary, but it's kind of like, what's it like to be a filmmaker, you know? And how each of you have kind of traveled your path to where you are here today. Also, I'd love to talk to you about what it's like to be an African-American filmmaker and make these films that are really tied to the African-American community. And the great example that the two of you have set for that, I think that's totally amazing. And then also we want to talk about the new films that you have and what's going on. So Kev, let's start with you. The 24th. I researched this, and like I said, truth is stranger than fiction. This movie is amazing. The story behind it is incredible. Tell us about this and how you came up with it and everything.
Well, many years back, I saw this photograph of this, trial. And this trial had 64 black soldiers kind of guarded by other soldiers, and these 64 black soldiers were on trial. And it was from the photographs of 1917. And the caption below said, the largest murder trial in American history. I researched it and found out it was really about the Houston riot of 1917. And they sent about 700 black soldiers to Houston, Texas in 1917 to guard this camp. It was called Camp Logan. And the camp was to train soldiers to go to World War I. Fortunately, the Houston police were just notoriously racist group of folks. And so the 700 black troops coming to Houston was just shocking to the community. I mean, these are black men with weapons. And so the police just started brutalizing them. And incident after incident after incident after incident. And these men, these soldiers, they were the 24th Infantry Division, the Buffalo Soldiers.
Right, right.
And so these guys had fought in the Philippines. They'd fought San Juan Hill, Spanish-American War. So these guys were, these were veterans, and these guys were guys that were used to being treated with a certain degree of dignity. Right. And so eventually what happens is that one of what we explore in the film is a character that's based on a real guy that all this really kind of happened to. And I fictionalized it, and he has a love relationship. But what happens is that he gets brutalized by the police. The word gets back to the camp that he's been killed. And 150 black soldiers marched on Houston, Texas, and went after the police.
Wow.
And I think the story was suppressed because it was a story of African Americans fighting back.
Right.
And so it's a really, I think, a really important film in historically in that sense that, this is a piece of history that none of us, black folks, white folks, nobody really knows much about.
Yeah, I couldn't believe I'd never heard of this. And what was the trial? The fact it's the biggest?
It's the largest murder trial in American history. 64 guys on trial at one time. And they're all on trial. There's just a photograph which blew my mind, was all these guys on trial together at one time. And I don't want to give it away, but there were several other trials after that as well, because there was like 150 guys that marched on the city.
Is it giving too much away that some of them were put to death, right?
No, I mean, you know, I think, you know, it's not hard to hard to imagine what the result of this is in some ways. But you know, these, you know, there are still family members today that are kind of arguing the case, trying to find, you know, justice for their, you know, their relatives that participated in it. And, you know, there really wasn't much of a trial, you know. So anyway, it's an important film. I hope that people kind of check it out.
Awesome. All right, I can't wait to see that. Okay, Morgan, so tell me a little bit what's going on, this Chromista thing and at CAA, and you're now out in Los Angeles. What's going on in Morgan Cooper's world?
Yeah, so currently right now I'm writing a show for Quibi. Wow. Which is a platform, a streamer that's going to drop early April. And so I'm writing a show. It's actually set here in Kansas City. It's called Black Coffee. And so writing that and about to begin development for a project for Universal TV. And so on the TV side of things, that's mostly, you know, consuming most of my creative bandwidth right now. But I'm also in the background writing a feature that I plan on shooting later this year. So,
boy, I'm exhausted just listening to that, man. That's totally, totally amazing. So you shoot videos is this amazing thing that I think is kind of autobiographical with you, that of how you started out. And what I said was so amazing is that you start as a cinematographer, so your directing and writing has really led itself visually. And there's a saying in filmmaking, it's called show, don't tell. And I think it takes a long time for filmmakers not to understand that. They keep thinking they want to have people tell things or something. Tell me a little bit about that, the show, don't tell, and particularly like in room tone.
Sound speed, this is room tone.
You know, like he keeps looking at the closet.
Camera speed. Garden, take two, marker.
Has the cinematography helped you in doing that?
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, I think visualization and visual storytelling is everything when, you know, you trust that the audience can understand a concept, you know, and audiences are smart, like, you know, and so I definitely agree the show don't tell, and really using language when necessary, you know, if it's just words, unless it's Sorkin, of course,
who can actually,
there's some people who could pull it off, but you know, with my style, it's definitely driven by visualization, you know, and trusting that the audience grasps onto the concepts that I put on screen. And so, yeah, cinematography has definitely influenced my writing.
Camera is set.
But it's really exciting because it's all under, you know, it's like a pyramid, and at the top of it is storytelling, and there are all these different facets of storytelling to lend itself to, you know, telling a particular story, cinematography being a part of it, writing, direction, style. And so it's just been really, really exciting over the past year to develop that part of my craft as a storyteller, you know, through writing. So I'm really enjoying it and having a good time, and just more than anything, just learning. I mean, that's why I tell everybody, it's like, you know, letting the art lead me. Everything else that comes is a byproduct of it, but like putting the art first and putting the craft first and just trying to get a little bit better.
With liberty and justice for who?
Every time I, you know, every time I type and every time I pick up the camera.
Yeah, that's what's amazing about the two of you is the directing is one thing, but writing's, you know, the key, right? I did a segment of you years ago for Show Me, and I go, hey, I just want to get some shots of you writing, and you're actually writing your screenplay. I was doing it.
They give you notes, and so your job is to kind of apply those notes.
Well, what's that like, the discipline of that? And I mean, because this story, you had to kind of adapt it. Like, there's a love interest in the 24th to come and to make it, you know,
sure,
a film.
Sure.
Tell me a little bit about that kind of writing process. And
well, yeah, it's like Morgan was saying, you know, you hope to always kind of, you know, nail the subject matter and find the point of the story. And I always tell my students, you know, it's not always just write what you know, you should also write what you believe in. And that's kind of been a big part of how I write, I think. You know, I try to find something I truly kind of care about that I feel is important in some way or another. The chair is an important thing because the chair you sit in to write, that should be your friend. And so when it becomes a problem and I get stuck and frustrated, whatever, I get out of that chair and I go do something else, because the chair should be a great place for you to go and hang out and do your thing. And it should not be the place that, you know, pisses you off.
Right. You know? Exactly. You I think know? That's my problem. I get a little too pissed off and then end up not sitting in the chair, you know? Like, I can write a script. I make this incredible beginning.
Right.
And then I get to that damn second act and I'm like, okay, now what? And then I jump to the end, but I get stuck. It's always the second act, you know.
The dreaded second act.
Yeah.
Well, you know, I tell my students, it's like, everybody's got a first act. But nobody's got a second act.
No.
You know, and then the second act is the hard part of the screenwriting, right?
Yeah. So, Morgan, what about you with writing? What's your process? How do you do this?
Yeah, somebody told me once, you write for the rewrite, yes. Right? And so it's just a matter of pushing through, you know. And it's also, you know, once again, over the past year, just finding my process through it. You know, I spent years cultivating my craft as a DP and finding how I pre-visualize projects, but now it's like I'm having to do that with writing and, you know, learning outlining and really diving into the story on an even deeper level as a writer. And so, you know, it's exciting and I just continue to learn, but I think the biggest thing is just sitting down and doing it. And there are going to be some days, you know, I learned that, you know, you don't necessarily feel like writing or something's not coming to you right away, but just stay creative and just write. And just get out in the world and like soak up inspiration through conversation, you know what I mean? Just keep an open mind about things.
The finishing of this set, it's gonna be dope.
And like, you know, like Kevin said, just like find the fun in it and find the joy in it. There are a lot worse things to be doing than writing a movie or a show. You know what I mean?
It's so really, problem to have, right?
Oh, 100%. That's exactly right. Yeah, so just staying grounded in that just realizing it's a blessing that we get to do what we do. So.
Yeah, man. You know, it's you know, he nailed it too. It's that thing, you've got to be willing to write poorly. You know, if you're not willing to write poorly, you can't write well. And it's because it's all about the rewrite. And so, you know, you kind of figure things out as you go along, but, you know, a lot of folks have a hard time writing poorly. And you got to be, you know, fairly kind to yourself, you know, not overly kind, but kind enough to yourself to let yourself keep moving forward, you know. You've got to be self-critical and you've got to be, you know, hold a standard to yourself, but you don't want to hold a standard to the point where it makes you stop.
Yeah, I was in L.A. and I got a job to write a feature off a short I did. And I thought this was going to be easy, but I kept getting stuck at this one point. And it was literally in the script. It's like, she goes to the cop shop, right? And it was like, she goes to the cop shop. And I kept like, okay, now what happens after that? She goes to the cop shop. And I got stuck. There was almost like a needle getting stuck. Right. Where I finally, a screenwriter came up to me and says, just crap something out, man. Just get her out of the cop shop and do whatever so that can move on to the next thing.
That's exactly it.
Morgan, have you done, I mean, you, the same thing. Like, just like you were saying, sometimes you just kind of have to do a little bit of bad writing within it to kind of get to the next thing, right?
Yeah, exactly. I mean, as you know, they say like the edit is where you solve problems and writing, you're creating problems. You know what I mean? So, 100%. Yeah. And, you know, I'm really curious, Kevin, like, you know, your process with your writing, with your stories. Do you start in the outlining phase or is it a situation where you just, you know?
Yeah, well, you know, you get an idea and hopefully the idea gets you juiced up, right? And then I usually write a beat sheet out. You know, I don't typically do a treatment. Sometimes when you get hired for a job, they want a treatment, so that's when I write a treatment. Yeah, yeah. But when I'm working for myself, I don't usually write a treatment. I really kind of write a beat sheet out and try to, you know, really give even page numbers. You know, like, I think this is going to take from page 1 to page 3. It's going to take page 5 to page 7. You know, just an idea in your head. All that stuff typically changes. But it gives you, and obviously the big things are the plot points, the midpoint, the plot points. That you know you're heading toward. And so that's kind of what I do. I mean, you know, everybody's kind of does their own thing. You got to figure out what works best for you. The controlling idea is another big thing for me, which is kind of the theme of the movie. And I'm always kind of looking for that. You typically don't know it, you know, when you get started. Sometimes you know it, or sometimes you think it might be this, but by hopefully moving forward, you know, this thing we're talking about, writing poorly sometimes to write well, that you discover kind of what it's really about, the comment that you're making on the film. And it's that comment that you're making on the film that, you know, that helps you to kind of unify it and kind of make it about a certain thing.
Yeah, so we write a script, now we got to shoot it, right?
Right.
And I think that's where your comfort zone comes in a little bit more, Morgan, because of your great cinematography. But what's incredible about your work is you do so much character development with shooting, you know? So once you've got something written, how are you transferring that to the screen? Are you storyboarding, or is it just kind of a, tell me a little bit about that?
Yeah, I mean, you know, it all starts really, you know, with the page, and you know, at the time, as a DP, I'm talking to the director, but when you're serving, yeah. You know, as the director, you know, just breaking down the script scene by scene and just, you know, what am I trying to say in the scene? Like, how does this propel into the next scene? You know, the flow, like, that's the biggest thing is just flow and tone. Like, that's something I'm very sensitive about is just like, how do I want a viewer to feel when they look at this frame? You know, finding ways to say more with less shots. Like, that's also something that's really important to me. I'm not the type to go out and just focus on coverage. You know, let's jump to a wide, medium, close-up. It's like, no, let's shoot with intention.
Action!
If I can tell this story in two shots, I'd rather do that than just jump around and waste a bunch of time with 6-7 camera angles that will never get used in the bay. So saying more with less is a big part of my process. And just once again, it just starts with the words and the character, you know, kind of going back to our conversation about process. It's just like, who are these people? You know what I mean? Like, that's going to determine the focal length I use, you know, how I capture them, how I light them. You know, it all really starts with who this person is, what's the headspace they're at in this point in the story. So,
you know, and Kevin, you won an Academy Award, so you know what you're doing.
And sometimes.
Sometimes. and you've been doing it for so long. But I mean, so, but how do you, so once you've written, my words are, and you get on the set, it changes, right?
Yeah. I mean, you know, there's that, the legendary, they, you know, I didn't realize this the other day that, you know, that I'd never talked about this much in class, you know, but, and it's something that, you know, filmmakers know, but you know, there's the movie you write, the movie you shoot, and the movie you edit.
Exactly.
And they're three different films.
Yes.
And a lot of people don't really know that. I mean, you just kind of take that for granted, you know, that everybody knows that, but that's something that you kind of don't really learn until you really start doing it. And that's a big thing, because you've got to be willing to go with what's flowing and what's developing. And it's like you're saying about writing with intent and shooting with intent. I mean, it's the same thing, the writing with intent, shooting with intent. Like the 24th, we only had 18 days to shoot that film.
Really?
Yeah, 18 days.
18 days?
18 days we shot that film. And
a period piece in 18 days?
A period piece in 18 days. And so there was no coverage. That's, you have to shoot with intent. You have to shoot knowing kind of how it's going to edit. You kind of have to plan the whole thing out for the most part. And that's a really good thing. I mean, you know, that kind of pressure makes you have to be more creative, you know? And so that's, it's, you know, I think sometimes video, digital, as great as it is, mm-hmm. It can kind of make you lazy. Mm-hmm. It kind of can make you kind of, I love what you're saying about shooting with intent, because, you know, you see a lot of people just shoot a lot.
Yeah.
And it's great to have a lot of coverage. 90% of the time, you don't use most of that stuff, you know? And so when you're shooting with intent, you know, you get what you really need.
Yeah, and I think also, you know, I don't do coverage at all. I storyboard it down. This totally sounds bizarre, but even if you watch like a Woody Allen film, there's a lot of long takes in that.
Yeah.
There's a lot. I think it's a lot more cinematic than you think it is, just by the way he's moving the character or the actors within the frame and the camera.
Right. Right.
And I think that you've got to stick to that discipline, because there are a lot of people on the set going, "Oh man, we need to do." And Morgan, just like you said, you go, "Nope, I got it." And you know, I'm sure you guys know how many people you say, "Are you sure?" And you just have to literally say, "Let's move on to the next scene." You know, and Morgan, so. Tell me about Ernest Dickerson and you know what he meant to you and as a DP, and how he's still kind of shaping your visual style today.
Yeah, I mean, you know, my introduction to Ernie's work were the Spike Lee films that I watched growing up with my dad. You know, my dad, he had me when he was 50, and so he was well up on, like,
nice.
Spike and Shaft. Like, those were the films that we watched growing up. And so I still remember, you know, watching Malcolm X for the first time, like, probably a little bit too young to like fully grasp some of the subject matter, but like it was just mesmerizing, like watching Ernest Dickerson's work, you know. And Juice was really my first introduction to like craft.
If you want respect, you gotta earn it. You gotta be ready to go down, stand up, and die for that stuff.
You you know what I mean, watching his work in that. And I'm like, I don't know what's going on. You know, I was, I think, 10 when I first saw it. Probably, once again, a little too young for the subject matter. But, like, watching it, I was just like, there's something to, like, how he's moving the camera and the blocking. Like, there's just, I felt like the magic in it, you know what I mean? That still sticks with me to this day. And it all goes back to Ernest Dickerson, who was a cameraman. He was Spike Lee's cameraman on a lot of his earlier films, and just a tremendous cinematographer who pivoted into directing. And so that's really the path that I'm taking in my career, my trajectory. So he's one of my biggest influences for sure.
What a great role to take, and a role model to pick. And let's talk about Spike. You've written with how many you've written with Spike now?
I've written three films with him.
And tell me about this new one. It's
The Five Bloods. Spike's got to be duh.
It's actually going to be the number five, too.
Right.
You know,
the Five Bloods.
Tell me a little bit about that. What's going on?
So it's about five black soldiers that were in Vietnam back in the day. And one of their main kind of comrades, they're kind of the leader of their platoon, was a brother that was killed. But his body was never retrieved. And so they go back today to try to find his body, but also to find some treasure that they buried at that time on the mission that they were on, it's going to be a really great film. I mean, Spike's, you know, we shot in Thailand.
Wow.
And you know, the fact that it's about black soldiers, mm-hmm. You know, there's really not been a black Vietnam soldier film. I mean, it's, you know, it's amazing to think about that. It's like, you know, you'd think there would be numerous ones, but one of those, you know, aspects of black life that's not been captured much. And of course, you know, black soldiers in Vietnam went through, you know, it's like you were saying about Malcolm, and the 60s and the 70s was a very turbulent time. You know, you're fighting for America and you don't even have rights yourself.
Right.
And so back home, people of the civil rights movement's going on, and you're fighting in a foreign country, and people back home are saying, you should be back here fighting with us.
Right.
And so, you know, these guys had a real, you know, were really challenged in a lot of different ways, and got a really great cast. And Delroy Lindo and Chadwick Boseman is in it. And so it's going to be really, really hip.
African American stories. I mean, not all your work, but predominantly a lot of it. You're not just a champion for African American stories, but of Kansas City. I mean, look at this awesome T-shirt you got on, man. The guy represents.
Kings.
And how cool that he's got signed a big-time CAA, but you're coming back here to shoot stuff. Tell me a little about getting the African-American stories, and not just that, Morgan, but here in Kansas City.
Yeah, I mean, telling Kansas City stories means everything to me, you know, and there are a lot of people in my life and, like, asking questions once, you know, Bel Air, that moment happened and everything that happened as a result, like, you know, are you just like, what are you going to do next? You're just going to leave? And like, and it's like, nah, like, my goal is to bring infrastructure for filmmaking back to Kansas City. You know, there's so many talented people in Kansas City who, you know, music, film, who leave and they never really come back, and so into their own community. And, you know, this is where my career started, and I intend to, you know, my goal really is to build infrastructure and provide opportunities for young kids who, you know, were on the east side and south side of Kansas City who didn't even know filmmaking was a career, an option for them in their life, you know. And so if I can be the person to inspire that change in my community and show kids that, hey, like, you can do this too. Like, I'm proof that you can do this. Like, you can be a cinematographer, you can be a writer, you can be an actor right here in Kansas City. You know, there are other options for you. Like, that means more to me than any sort of award I could ever receive, any sort of film I could make, just to, like, show them, hey, it's possible and you could change your life. So
yeah, this, so proud of you that you're doing that. You're remembering KC, and in Lawrence, you have a lot of local crews, and you help out the locals too, you know, like, on your crews, right, Kevin?
So sure.
Yeah,
I think it's great that you're going to stay, because, you know, Kansas City is a great city, like you're saying, and you know, unfortunately, the tax incentive thing is such a huge problem. And, you know, there are a lot of projects that, when we get opportunities, you could bring them to Kansas City if we could compete with the tax credit. And literally those movies go to other states because of the tax. Yep. And that's, I mean, it's not because of anything else. It's all about the tax. You know, unfortunately, it's, you know, it's the film business.
Yeah.
It's show business.
Yeah.
You know, it should be business show, you know, because that's really what defines it.
Yeah, Fargo, the television series, is one of my favorite. And Chris Rock in a new season set in Kansas City, but shot, I think it...
Chicago.
In Chicago.
Yeah.
And that really depressed a lot of us local filmmakers. You know, sure. Justin Gardner, he's for the Film Society, and they're starting a new movement about trying to get this whole thing rectified.
Right.
So
yeah.
We got to fight, though. You know what I mean? That's our job, because I feel like if no one stands up for that, it'll just be more of the same. And
exactly.
There'll be more Fargos that are set in Kansas City, these projects that just go elsewhere. So we need people from here who actually care about the city. Like Kevin said, it's a business. And those people out there don't care where you're from. It's all about the bottom line, right? And so being from Kansas City, like, we have to be the ones to fight and say, like, no, like, this project belongs here. And I think that's what'll really move the needle. But it has to be intentional or nothing will change.
Okay, you guys, thank you so much for being here. I've got like two heavyweights here. I this is my third show, and I was like really nervous. Thank you so much for being here, Kevin. Thanks again for being here. Morgan, can't wait to see what's coming up next with you. And again, love the jersey, man. That's got to pop on video.
Yes, indeed.
Okay, all right. Well, that's another edition of Art House, a Flatland conversation about all things art and cinema. But I want you to do me one favor. I just want you to go out and see a movie. Thanks for joining us.